Welcome back. With me now is Dawn Port. She is here to talk about some of the decisions that may have to be made in emergency situations and at the end of life. Welcome, Dawn.
Thank you.
Thanks so much for being here with us.
Yes, happy to be here.
So my first question is something of a scenario. If someone is in a situation where they've done everything they can, they've done maximum medical treatment, but they're going to die, it's going to result in death. What are some of the life-sustaining treatments that at that point they'll need to consider?
Okay, this is a very good question because we're frequently not very comfortable talking or even thinking about these kinds of things at the end of life. So some of the life-sustaining treatments that we can consider at the end of life, including cardiopulmonary resuscitation, would be the one that I think most people are familiar with.
CPR.
And most of us have this vision of what we've seen on television. We may not have ever seen anyone have this done, you know, in real life, and so we take what we know from Hollywood. And there really are some risks that we need to consider when we're thinking about whether we want to have CPR done or not, and thinking about what is our quality of life now, what could be our quality of life after we have CPR if we survive that procedure being mm-hmm. done to us. And some of the risks that we have to think about is, especially if we're frail and elderly and maybe have a chronic illness, those individuals are less likely to survive CPR. And they are more likely to have some kind of additional trauma that would make their quality of life, if they survive that procedure, not as optimal as even it was before that event. So those are some of the things that we really have to think about. Do I want to go through that kind of procedure and maybe have the possibility of having broken ribs or maybe a fractured spleen or not even surviving that event? And again, based on what we see on TV in Hollywood, you know, everybody makes it through CPR. Mm-hmm. And the facts are really that if someone has CPR outside of the hospital, their chances of surviving are less than 5%. And if they have an event in the hospital where they need CPR, the chances of surviving and being discharged from the hospital and having a good quality of life afterwards is only about 15%. So we really have to think about those kinds of things. It's much more complicated than just whether you want CPR or not.
Okay.
And those are some of the things that your provider, whether it's your physician or a nurse practitioner or a physician assistant, will ask you about. Some of the other things that we think about at the end of life that are life-sustaining treatments are, do we want artificial nutrition or artificial hydration at the end of life? And there are some situations where people would really consider, you know, this is appropriate. If you're having some kind of surgery or radiation for certain kinds of cancer, you may very well want to consider a temporary feeding tube to help give you nutrition during that time when it's expected that you won't be able to swallow for a while because of these procedures, but will be able to recover that ability after the procedures are over. Or a good example is someone who has a neuromuscular disease like Lou Gehrig's disease. And probably the most famous person we know about is Stephen Hawking.
Mm-hmm.
And he has lived for many years with that disease process. And he has a feeding tube that helps him have nutrition. Now, there's some cases where you maybe wouldn't want to consider that. If you had cancer and you were well advanced in the treatment of cancer and looking at the end of life, you may not want to have that sort of thing. Or if you have severe dementia, you may not want to consider having that because it's not been shown to improve a person's quality of life or prolong their life. So, you know, providing nutrition and providing fluids is such a way of showing that we care for someone. It's a very social thing. And to not provide these things is a very difficult thing for families and individuals to think about not doing. But we know at the very end of life that people, after they can go for a long time without eating, and they really, especially after a few days, really don't notice that, that hunger kind of disappears. And people worry about, oh, I'm going to starve to death, or I'm going to die from thirst. And IV fluids really don't change that perception of thirst. So there's other things that we can do to help people at the end of life for that. Another issue would be dialysis. Another one would be just looking at what can we do to provide comfort care at the end of life.
Okay.
So, does that help?
Yes, that's perfect. A lot of information. Yes. We're actually almost out of time. Can you just quickly talk about what hospice care is, just super quick, so people understand what that is?
Yes, absolutely. The difference between palliative care or comfort care is the other thing people might know about. And hospice care is palliative care can be given any time during a time that a person is sick. Hospice is for the last about 6 months.
Okay, perfect. That's all the time we have. Thank you so much. I appreciate it. I want to thank my guests, Don Port and Alice Hinshaw. And remember to stay fit, stay well, and stay healthy for life with Healthy Living for Life. Thanks for watching.
Healthy Living for Life is brought to you by Mountain Pacific Quality Health. We'd love to hear from you. If you have suggestions for future programs, visit our website at mpqhf.org or call us at 406-443-4020. You can also catch us on YouTube by visiting our website and clicking on the YouTube icon. Special thanks to Fire Tower Coffee House and Roasters. Production facilities provided by Video Express Productions.